Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you're all having a fantastic day. I just wanted to get on and talk about this, but I want to be very clear when I'm talking about how being in a toxic relationship is like an addiction. I don't mean that it is an addiction. There's similarities, and I wanted to kind of talk about how there's similarities and how often the treatments can be very similar. Okay. So what I mean by this is that when we look at addiction, it's often a coping mechanism that we developed in order to help us in some way, either to escape or to, dampen or relieve some pain, whether that's physical or emotional, right? And often there's some good things to it, right? Otherwise you wouldn't keep doing it. But there's enough negative things, or it's affecting your life in other negative ways. And what makes it an addiction is that even though it's negatively impacting your life, maybe in the form of your relationships, your career, your health, or whatever, you still are unable to, let it go or find different coping skills. So this is often a lack of resources, really, and a lack of trauma-informed care, because the addiction, again, is a coping mechanism. It's that person's best attempt at easing their pain, right? So, regardless of whether that's an addiction to substances or whether it's a behavioral addiction to maybe like gambling or shopping or food or whatever it might be, if it becomes something that's sort of out of control, and sort of takes a lot of their energy, then that energy is no longer being put into the areas of their life that they need it to be in, i.e., their relationships, their career, their health. And those are the negative impacts of that addiction. So, how is that similar to being in a toxic relationship? Well, being in a toxic relationship also comes with a lot of shame and isolation that comes, that's similar to addiction. So there's a difference between being the cause of a toxic relationship and being affected by it, right? So I'm not suggesting that by making these, by making these observations of similarities, that I'm trying to say that anyone is the cause of the place that they find themselves in, whether that's an addiction to something or whether they find themselves in a toxic relationship. So I want to be very clear about that. However, we're still a person who is either interacting in a toxic relationship or in an addiction, and we are the person who's acting or reacting to whatever pain, right? So the ways in which an addiction and being in a toxic relationship are similar in is that we often develop coping mechanisms, and maybe within the relationship, the coping mechanisms show up as people pleasing or fawning or just basically pushing down every part of yourself and sometimes going against your own interests, and in that way they're very similar, right? So when we think about also the physiological effects of being addicted to something and being in a toxic relationship, we can see that the nervous system is dysregulated, and that the roller coaster ride of the hormonal ride that we do when we're interacting in these situations, and interacting with addiction is very similar, right? Because much like an addiction, there's some positives to it, right? Same with being in a toxic relationship. If it was 100% bad, 100% bad in a toxic relationship is the worst, right? The worst thing that you can imagine. However, when we dial that back, there's often just enough of a kernel of goodness, whether it's your memories of how it used to be, and that's what kind of keeps your hope alive, or your partner is giving you little tiny tidbits of, like little tiny bits of love sprinkled in amongst all the toxicity, but it's enough to maybe give you that hope and to feed that part of you, right? And it does something to your hormonal response, right? So think about it, when a person who's addicted to something gets the thing that they're addicted to, there's a release of, you know, feel good hormones, whether that's, you know, going to be adrenaline or serotonin or dopamine or whatever it is that they're seeking to, in their attempt to find some balance and some normalcy to cope, some whatever relief, release, maybe escape, whatever it is for them, that's what's happening on the physical level. And so when you think about it in a relationship standpoint, if your partner gives you a little crumb or even goes to the extent of love bombing you, then that's going to release all of those feel good hormones. And so you're riding this roller coaster, right? And so even after you've gotten out of that relationship, what happens is that, you know, your nervous system is still in a state of dysregulation, and, you know, you're more apt to have a hard time sort of regulating your emotions and be more triggered easily, right? And you're maybe sometimes craving that little bit, that whatever it was that they gave, the little crumb, or you're craving those times when you were being love bombed because it felt like love, obviously, at the time. And so there's a physiological craving that we have to acknowledge, right? So when you think about all the ways that people who are in recovery can benefit from, you know, various types of therapy and various approaches to helping them find balance and, you know, healing those unhealed wounds, much could be said for the healing from a traumatic relationship or a toxic relationship, because the things that we need are healthy relationships, healthy interactions with other people. We need, you know, therapy to help us, you know, unpack it all, help us integrate things, help us to find clarity, help us to figure out, you know, our forward plans, that sort of thing. And we need to maybe help in kind of reconnecting with ourselves, right? And that's where, you know, taking care of yourself on the physical level can be really helpful. And, you know, engaging in exercise and meditation and mindfulness practices and all of those things. Those are all of the things that I would suggest to someone who's trying to recover from addiction. So the only difference would be is if they were addicted to substances and they needed some medical intervention to help with the process of becoming clean. But I would still have all of those other things in the picture as far as, you know, a healing plan or a healing path to getting themselves in a place where they can be in a healthy relationship or they can have healthy coping mechanisms if, they're recovering from addiction. So that's why I just wanted to get on and talk about how these things are similar, because I feel like there's a lot of shame and stigma around all of those things. And the more we can talk about how things are often like on a subconscious level, we don't even realize that we're doing these things, then we can talk about how the ways in which we can heal from them also can be best approached by engaging the subconscious mind, right? Because we can't think our way out of every problem. Not every problem is going to be a conscious mind fix. There's lots of things that our conscious mind can do for us, but when it comes to deep healing, which I think is really important to, recover from addictions and, toxic relationships, when you recognize that a lot of the triggers that we have, or the types of beliefs that we have around things, go back to different times in our lives, being able to kind of tap into that can be really deeply healing, because we are conscious mind in this time, but we can be in our subconscious mind in different times, if that makes sense. So I just wanted to share that with you and see if it resonates. I'd love to hear your thoughts on it. I know that it's a very simplistic sort of approach to it all, but I think just in general to, open the conversation around addiction, around, people who find themselves in toxic relationships, because I feel like there's a lot of, blaming and shaming that goes on. It's like, well, you put up with that, or you didn't say no to that, or you didn't have any boundaries. So, like, but those are all things that a person can't really know until they know. And if they weren't taught those things, or they weren't modeled those things growing up, how are they to know that? And it's the same as blaming someone who's addicted to something for their addiction, when really it's often their best way of